This video is gonna be jam-packed with a ton of information on how to get started with Premiere Pro, so if that's what you're looking for, keep watching. So when you first open up Premiere Pro, it's gonna bring you to this screen right here where you have the option of creating a new project or opening a previous project. So I'm just gonna click on new project. Next, it's gonna open up this window right here, and I'm only gonna focus on the project name and the project location here. So I'm just gonna go ahead and name this really quick and then click on this drop-down tab and select the location that I want to save this file. So I'm just gonna go to my desktop and click on my folders for every project. And this group of folders right here is actually a template that I use for every single video project. And I'm gonna include this template in a link down in the description that you can download for free. And that pack's also gonna contain a bunch of different assets that I'll be using throughout the rest of this video. So I'm just going to click on my project files folder, and this is going to contain all of my project files to include the autosave files, and just click choose and then click on create. Now, once your project's been created, it's gonna bring you to this screen here, which is gonna have a bunch of different tables and can look super, super complicated, but I'm gonna try to break it down and simplify it the best that I can. So you can move these around and customize them any way that you want. And really just optimize it to what's gonna be best for your workflow. And if you get to a point to where you find yourself like lost and you don't know, you know, how to fix this issue, just go up here to Window, go to Workspaces, and then go down to Reset to Save Layout, and that's going to reset it back to the default settings. Premiere also has this workspace tab here with a bunch of different workspaces that make it super easy for you to be able to do certain things. So if I had a vertical video for like a YouTube short, I could just click on this vertical tab here, and this is designed for it to be fast and efficient for me to be able to edit a vertical video. And if I'm not editing a vertical video, all I have to do is just go back up here to this little workspace tab and then go back over to the editing tab, which is where I typically like to do all my editing at. So the first table that we have here is the project table. And this is just where you're going to import all of your media. So that's your footage, your audio, your music, sound effects, whatever you have that you want to use whenever you're editing your video, you're going to import it in the project table. So in order to do this, what I found to be the fastest or the most efficient is to just go to that folder for every project and then click and drag all the folders that you want into Premiere. So just going to click and drag it over into that project table. And depending on whether or not you have files actually in those folders, it may or may not actually import the folder. So what you can do is manually go ahead and create bins inside of Premiere. So that's gonna be what is actually a folder. It's called a bin inside of Premiere. So I can create a new bin by clicking on this little bin button here. And the first one that I'm going to create is going to be our sequence bin, because we're gonna be creating a sequence here in just a minute. So I'm going to number these so they stay in chronological order. I'm just going to name this sequence. I'm also gonna create another bin for audio. And the only reason you're creating bins is just to stay organized, because you're gonna be going back and forth between your project table and your timeline. So you wanna make sure that it's easy to find the things that you're looking for. That way you're not spending a whole bunch of time looking for different files and things like that. So I'm just gonna create a few more bins. Now, you don't necessarily need to create all these bins if you don't want to. Like, these are just the ones that I use for my videos. One thing that I've done to save you a ton of time is I've created a Premiere Pro project file that you can save into that project files folder. And instead of creating a new project in Premiere Pro, just open up that project file and it's already gonna have those bins created for you. Now that all of our media has been imported, it's time to create a sequence so we can start editing our video. So I'm just gonna go down here to this little new item button and then go up here to sequence. And it's gonna open up this window here at first. All I'm gonna do is go down to digital SLR, drop down the folder for 1080p and select 1080p24, and then go up here to the settings tab. For editing mode, I'm just gonna leave this at DSLR. Time base, you can select whatever you want. I'm gonna choose 23.976 because that's what I shot my video at. I did a more in-depth video on frame rates. If you'd like to learn more about that, I'll leave it up in the YouTube cards now. For frame size, this is currently set to a normal 1080p video. If I wanted to change this to 4K, I could just type in 3840 by 2160. And that's gonna give me that 4K 16:9 normal aspect ratio. If I wanted to do a vertical video, I could just change this to 1080 by 1920. And that's going to give me that 9:16 vertical video. So I'm just gonna go with 1920 by 1080. And then if you want, you can create presets for every single one of these. Then you can go back over here and it's gonna create this custom folder, and you can click on whichever one you want to automatically generate that sequence. I'm gonna go back over here under settings. I'm gonna go ahead and name this main sequence and then press okay. And then I'm just gonna click and drag that main sequence into that sequence bin. That way we're staying organized. Now that a sequence has been created, you can now see that there is a timeline, and there's also something over here in this program monitor here. So what we have here is the playhead down on the timeline, and this is what you use to scrub through the different parts on your timeline. And whatever you have this playhead hovering over, it will show over here in the program monitor. So now that we have a timeline created, we can now start adding some footage to it. So I'm gonna go ahead and drag on all of my footage onto the timeline. And if this pops up here, I'm just gonna go ahead and select keep existing settings because we don't want our sequence settings to change at all. Now there's various different layers to the timeline. So we have our video layers here, and then we have our audio layers down here. And when it comes to positioning clips on the timeline, if I were to put video number 2 above video number 1, you actually no longer see video number 1. So it's just something to keep in mind whenever it comes to positioning your clips. Now when it comes to positioning audio underneath, it's actually just going to play all of the audio from every single layer at once. So if you want to zoom in on your timeline, you can click on this little bar here and then just drag it over, or just press the plus button. And if you want to zoom out, just drag it the opposite direction or press the minus button. If you want to play back what's on your timeline, just position the playhead where you want it to be and just press the space bar. Now, in order to cut clips, you can simply just go over here and click on the blade tool and just select where you want to cut your clip at, and then create another cut and then delete it. And this takes forever. So what I did is, in the link below, you can find my keyboard shortcuts. And in order to install it, just go up here to Premiere Pro, go down to keyboard shortcuts, and don't worry about whatever it's already set to. Just click on save as, and you can leave this at whatever it's default at and just press okay. And then just go up here to go. If you're on Windows, just navigate to your documents folder and then click on Adobe, and then go over here to Premiere Pro. Click on your version of Premiere Pro, so mine is 23.0. Click on this profile folder, go down here to the Mac folder, and then just click and drag my shortcuts over into that folder. Then when you open Premiere back up, just go back up here to keyboard shortcuts. And if you click on the drop down here, you will see Tyler's keyboard shortcuts on. Just select that and press okay. And now you have all the shortcuts that I'm currently using. So now whenever I go to cut my clips, I'm just going to position the playhead where I want the cut to begin and just press W on the keyboard, which stands for add edit. And then I'm gonna go to the next point to where I want the cut to be. And then I'm going to press W again, and that's going to create that second cut. And with that portion of the clip highlighted that you want to delete, press S on the keyboard, and that's going to ripple delete that section. And what that did is it removed that section that you didn't want and snapped everything back together. Now that I have all of my clips cut on the timeline, I want to go and add some music. So for that, I use Epidemic Sound, which is actually the sponsor of today's video. Epidemic Sound allows you to get unlimited downloads of over 35,000 tracks and 90,000 different sound effects. I also like that I can find a music track or a sound effect and use it in my videos and not have to worry about copyright issues. One thing that's really helpful for me is their playlist feature, because I'll find a song that I really like, but I don't necessarily want to use in a specific video. So all I have to do is just save it to a playlist. And then the next time I go to look for music for one of my videos, I can just go straight to that playlist, and it allows me to be able to find music so much faster. So I can go into my playlist and find a song that I want, download it. And if I want to go and find a quick sound effect, I can do that too. Then I'll just go ahead and drag in my music and sound effects. And then I can just drop them onto the timeline. You can try Epidemic Sound for free for the next 30 days by using my link down in the description. Thank you so much to Epidemic Sound for sponsoring today's video. Now, if you wanna add text to your video, all you have to do is go down here to the type tool and then click anywhere within the frame and just type what you want your text to say. And then go up here to window and click on essential graphics and go ahead and click on your text till it's highlighted in red here. And now that it's highlighted, you can go in and change the font to whatever you want. And then change this to extra bold. And then I can make this bigger if I want. And then I can also click up here and center it up within the frame. And if you want to change the appearance of the text, you can change the fill color by just making sure that this box is turned on and clicking and selecting whatever color that you want. If you want to add a drop shadow, stroke, background, you can do all those changes down here. What's nice now is that if you have a whole bunch of text on the timeline and you want to make changes to every one of them all at once, all you have to do is just select every single one of them, and then it's going to open up here in the Essential Graphics tab, and you can change, let's say, the color if you want, and that's going to make those changes instantly. A really cool way to spice up your video is to add some effects. So in order to do that, I'm just gonna go over here to the project table and go to these double arrows and go down to effects. And one that I really like is the transform effect. And I'm just gonna click and drag that transform effect onto whatever clip that I want it to be on. Then I'm gonna go and select that clip and then make sure that I have toggled on effect controls up here where the source monitor was originally at. Then scroll down here to the transform effect here. And in order to animate this effect, we're gonna be using keyframes. Only thing I'm gonna be animating is the scale. So I'm just going to make sure that I position the playhead at the very beginning of the clip. And I'm gonna go over here and click on the stopwatch here next to scale. And that's going to create a keyframe right here. And then what I'm gonna do is just go over just a little bit and I'm going to change this to like 105. And it's going to create a second keyframe. And what I'll then do is I'm gonna go ahead and drag that second keyframe to the very far right. And that's gonna bring that to the very end of the clip. And then I'm gonna hold down shift and select my first keyframe. So that should have both of them highlighted. Right click and then select ease in. And that's just gonna make it much more smooth. And then I'll play it back. And you have this cool little dynamic zoom looking effect. In order to save myself a bunch of time later, because I use this effect often, what I'll do is I'm going to right click on transform and select save preset. I'm gonna name this dynamic zoom and then leave it set to scale and then press okay. And now if I wanna add this to my second clip, I can just go down to presets, click on dynamic zoom and drag it onto that second clip. Make sure the second one is highlighted and just make sure that second keyframe is dragged all the way to the end. And that applies it so much faster. If you wanna add a transition, one that you can simply do that's pretty commonly used is add a cross dissolve in between these two clips here. And what you can do is zoom this in a little bit, make it bigger, and you can play around and make this shorter or longer and just kind of modify it to what you like best. And then it's just going to transition into that next clip. You can also add a cross dissolve at the very beginning or at the very end. And that's just going to fade the video in or it'll fade the video out. When I'm ready to color correct and color grade my video, the first thing I'm gonna do is go down here to this new item button and select adjustment layer and then make sure this matches my sequence settings and press okay. Then I'm going to click and drag that adjustment layer above my video clips and then I'm going to stretch it across because I'm gonna use this adjustment layer to affect both clips. Then I'm just gonna go up here to the color workspace and Lumetri color should be opened up over here on the right. And then over here on the left, I'm just going to make sure that I have my scopes turned on. If you don't see this, just go up to window and select Lumetri scopes. Then in order to make sure that you have all the scopes that I do, just right click, make sure that you have the vector scope YUV turned on, which is this scope right here. Parade RGB, which is this scope down here, and then waveform Luma, which is this scope right here. And these three scopes are what I use to make sure that my colors are actually doing what I think they're doing. I can look at the frame itself and see what's going on in the frame, but a lot of times your eyes can be deceiving, so I like to go back and forth between the frame and these scopes. I use the vector scope here to measure my saturation, so if I bring this up to 200, you can see it gets bigger, and if I bring it down to zero, it gets smaller. I'm just gonna use that to make sure that I'm not oversaturating or undersaturating my image. And then the waveform Luma here is what I use to measure my exposure as well as to see how far I can push my colors. I don't ever want anything to touch 100 up here, which is pure white, or anything to touch down here at the bottom at zero, which is pure black, because I'm gonna be losing some detail. Down here for the parade RGB, I just use this to check my white balance. And ideally, I just want to be able to draw one straight line across and see that all of my colors are evenly dispersed. And if they're not, you can see by just adjusting the temperature slider, I'll add some blue in, and you can see that this is clearly not right. And also, if I look at the frame, it's also too blue. If I bring it over to the opposite direction and add some warmth in, you can see that it's not correct as well. So when you're playing around with your white balance and trying to make sure it's correct, you want to be able to draw that straight line that goes across. And you can make those adjustments with the temperature and tint sliders. But for this tutorial, I'm just going to use a LUT. So I'm just going to first make sure that I have my adjustment layer selected. And then I'm going to go up here and make sure that basic correction is opened up. Go up here to input LUT and click on the drop down and select browse. Then I'm going to select my S-Log 3 LUT and I'm going to open it. And that's going to take that flat picture profile into something that has some color and looks good. This video is actually shot a little bit underexposed. So instead of actually making the adjustments to the adjustment layer and it affecting all clips, this specific clip was underexposed. So I'm just gonna click on that clip, go back over here under Lumetri Color, and I'm going to raise the exposure up just a little bit. I think that looks pretty good right there. I'll also double check my second clip just to make sure that one's all good. And you know what, let's just go ahead and bring that exposure up just a little bit as well. Now, in order to color grade this video, what you can do is just go down here to the Creative tab and then make sure that you have your adjustment layer selected and click on this Look dropdown. And Premiere has built in a bunch of cool LUTs already, so I'm just going to select one of them. And this looks really bad, so in order to fix this, I just need to adjust the intensity slider. So I'm gonna bring this down, and I don't need this to be at 100. I can bring this down as low as I like until I have a look that I actually like. And let me go ahead and look at the second clip as well and toggle this on and off a few times just to see if it makes a difference. And yeah, I think I like that there. So when you're ready to export your video, just select everything that you have on your timeline and press the / button. And that's going to highlight the area on the timeline that you want to export. And then go up here to the export tab. First, go down here to media file and just make sure that this is toggled on. That way you can start making some changes. And then go up here to file name and name this whatever you want. Next, select the location that you want to save it to. So click on this here and just click save. For preset, you can bypass this here because it'll change to custom here in a second. And for format, go ahead and just select H.264. Then go down here to video and make sure that that's turned on. Drop down this video tab and you can select match source, and that's going to match what your sequence was, and then drop down this tab for more. Make sure you have the box checked for render at maximum depth, and then check the box for use maximum render quality. For encoding settings, if you can, select hardware encoding. Not everyone's computer will allow it. So if that's the case, just select software encoding. Then for profile, change this to high. Level should be set to 4.2. Then scroll down to your bitrate settings and change this to CBR and change your target bitrate to 50. Next, just make sure that your audio tab is turned on. That way your audio exports with your video as well. And then just click export. Did you like the music that I used in this video? Go check out my full playlist of my favorite tracks on Epidemic Sound using my link down in the description. Now, I didn't go over how to add subtitles to your video, but if that's something that you'd like to learn more about, check out this video right here. My name's Tyler, and if you want to learn more about video editing tips, consider subscribing and hitting the bell so you don't miss anything. I'll see you in the next video.